Hey guys, okay, so here's the thing. I'm a digital games technologist, which means I'm a graduated professional game developer. And I wanted to give a more in-depth look at the gameplay footage we have for Armored Core 6. I don't want to go into too much detail, like specific game design jargon things, so as not to make this sound like a classroom type of thing. Yeah, anyways, let's just get to it. Okay, first of all, take a look at all the verticality here, man. So many ways of completing the same level. This reminds a bit of Sonic 1. The Sonic 1's short stages had many different routes that tended to be like easier, normal, or harder routes, which gave the game a high replay value. This was essential since the game was rather short. In AC6, these different route things synergizes very well with the customizable nature of ACs. Going on. Right. Huge props to both animators and gameplay programmers that together created this feeling that ACs are super fucking heavy and there is way to every movement while still retaining a high level of maneuverability. Also, of course, huge props to every artist, from 3D modeling to the texture people and the shader guys too. Incredible stuff. The way the laser light is baked, I think. Fake it. I can't see that much in this video. The way it's baked in the AC and how it reflects on the ground, colors too, incredible. Attention to detail is amazing. Look at the side boosters activating when a player moves the AC. Great stuff. Alright, so camera movement feels very smooth, really good. Sound design is crazy. Look at the smoke coming out of the boosters after landing, man. Just love it. That's more of a fanboy moment, honestly, than a game design thing. Anyways, love the scenery. Alright, so here's some great level design. There's lots of small red lights peppered throughout the stage. These denote where there is solid ground for the player in a non-obtrusive way. This might not seem like much, but this makes gameplay feel much smoother in the mind of the player. They don't realize it, but they're thinking much less about not so important stuff like where to land, leaving more brain power for other stuff. Lighting is great too, just video games are so advanced now, I love it. Right. So here the player does this thing where they're flying forward fast, which developers have said in interviews that this is a very important new mechanic in the game, and we can clearly see why. Let's talk about how pre-production works in the development of a video game. In pre-production, game designers will, among other things, decide what the main pillars of the gameplay will be. These can be derived from knowledge the team gained based upon feedback from the previous games, feelings they want the player to feel, etc. In AC6 case, we know from developer interviews that they wanted players to give more attention to melee combat and comboing, right? Making combos. We also know that stages are now much bigger than before. This gives game designers two problems. How are players gonna cross much bigger gaps than before in these sprawling stages? And also, how are players gonna consistently cross the gap between them and the enemies to inflict melee hits? How is this going to be incentivized? This simple mechanic of flying forwards really fast solves these two problems, right? There is this concept in design, game design, that Shigeru Miyamoto clear synthesized as follows. A good idea doesn't just solve one problem, it solves multiple problems at the same time. And that makes a ton of sense, if you think about it, right? If you have a mechanic that is useful both in traversing stages and fighting enemies, you're gonna have to learn only one mechanic for both things. That's scaling two birds with one stone. Now, this might seem like a new mechanic, but for me, it really resembles how overboosting worked in previous entries of the series. Overboosting was a mechanic present in Armor Core 2 to Armor Core 4 Answer. It was usable only by some cores, which is the main body piece of an Armored Core. Overboosting lets you drain a lot of energy, which is basically stamina, to cross the battlefield with great speed. The thing here is that it seems that now every Armored Core can use this similar ability, which to me is a great addition, as it jives perfectly with the new bigger stages and the more melee focused combat. And well, I wonder if cores in AC6 will have some new mechanics that differentiate them from each other or not. Actually, I don't believe it will, so as not to confuse new players too much. That's fine though. Also, when we're doing this, there's some motion blur. I'd say this is a great use of motion blur. Alright, so here I'm gonna go off a bit from Vatividia's gameplay breakdown of this footage. And why is that? Because Vati was at the live showing of the FromSoft guys playing this, and he confirms in his video that what's happening in this part of the video is the soft lock locking in on all of these enemies. You can also tell by the great sound design. And seconds later, the player then chooses to hardlock on one of them. That's why initially, when the player shoots missiles here, they're divided by each one of the enemies. More on soft versus hardlock controversy in a bit. I believe that here is when the player hardlocks on this enemy, as you can hear by the sound design. Alright, so lots to unpack here. First, great showing of how the overboosting-like mechanic works wonders for crossing the gap and hitting an enemy with a melee sword attack, right? The player then side boosts during the overboost to better position themselves to attack here. Amazing fast dynamic movement while still bearing that sensation of heavy, heavy weight. Love all the side boosting here. Side boost was basically introduced in the 4th gen of Armored Core, which was the debut of Hidetaka Miyazaki, by the way. But these games were like mind-numbingly fast. Side boosting caused all kinds of jerky camera movements, made the giant robots feel a bit weightless, etc. Other than that, it gave a whole new way of approaching movement in these games, and I'm super glad it's here, better than ever. If you really think about it, it's like dodging in other character action games, just without the invincibility frames, which some consider a staple of the Dark Souls series, by the way. Anyways, here we have this huge leaping, highly telegraphed attack. I really like this. In previous Armored Cores, enemies basically just shot at you. This makes for much more interesting encounters, in my opinion. If you're close doing melee attacks, it's a great time to go away, go back to shooting, and forces this new game loop of melee and ranged attacks that they're trying for this game. Alright, let's go back to the soft and hard lock and stuff. There has been a huge debate in the Armored Core community over this, and as a game developer, I really wanted to give my two cents over this. If you have never played an Armored Core before, here's the memo. Until Armored Core 4, which came out in 2006, 9 years after the first game, there was only what is called soft lock, and it worked like this. There was this square on your screen, that's your lock on area. If your enemy is inside this square, great, you're shooting directly at them. It might seem a bit too easy, but that's because gameplay in Armored Core is very fast, so you really need the big square instead of just a small crosshair in the middle of the screen. And this worked great too for hitting multiple enemies at the same time, say with your missiles. Just like in this footage, this soft lock-on lets you tackle your encounters in this very broad way. Given how freaking fast Armored Core gameplay is, though, this means that if you fight a faster Armored Core, meleeing was very hard. And that's why in the earlier games, like the really early games, there were systems that made it so the melee attacks basically followed the enemy a bit. Not a very meticulous way of combat, but fun nonetheless, of course. And that's why melee combat focused games tend to have the more traditional hard lock-on system, so that even if an enemy is very fast, you can still keep track of them. That's why Armored Core 4 and 4 Answer had hard lock-on built in too, because the games were so much faster than previous generations. So, I'm here to defend the developers on this one, because they brought the best of both worlds, it seems. There's both soft and hard lock-on. When you're far away shooting, you might want to focus on the bigger picture, hitting every enemy with your missiles. Or you might want to get in close and personal for some slaps to the enemy's face, tracking them very well, which is the only way to make these melee fights more cinematic than ever. And as we'll see later, it works wonders. Combat looks amazing now. This also goes to reinforce the previously stated game look of ranged and melee combat. Right, so here we see again how the quote-unquote overboosting mechanic is also in combat, not only for crossing the gaps, but also for actually attacking the enemies, even pushing them from ledges. This is really great, because it gives not only a new way of melee attacking, but also the effects are different. The enemy isn't just staggered, they go flying away. This creates a really dynamic type of encounter where you can intentionally throw an enemy close to another enemy and say launch a missile with an area of effect that hits both at the same time for the cost of one. Very dynamic. It's also pretty funny too. Here's the hard lock sound again. Watch how the player moves. Notice anything? When the player is locked around an enemy, since they're always facing the enemy, they're always moving around the enemy. Now, why is this relevant? Because this makes your movement predictable. Not for enemy AI probably, but for other players. This is This is important because player versus player battles are a very important part of the Armored Core series, and players take it very seriously. If any of the more serious PvP players have concerns over the hard lockdown, know this. Enemies relying too much on it will move predictably, and you can punish them accordingly. Also, obviously, you can also hard lock on, so it's not like it's an unfair advantage only some players have. I guarantee you that it will only make our online battles even more dynamic. I can't wait. Yeah. Look at those particles, beautiful. Alright, so here, the player uses their back-mounted shield to mitigate the damage from this salvo of bullets. There's this effect at the start of shooting that makes it look like it's mitigating more damage, which is kind of like a parry system. However, a parry system is a more risk versus reward oriented mechanic. While this doesn't offer much in the way of risks, you deploy the shield at the wrong time, no biggie. In general, risk versus reward mechanics create very dynamic, multi-dimensional encounters. This, however, makes it much more approachable for beginners. However, I'm gonna be honest, I'm afraid it will lead to new players playing very defensively. Just like in Dark Souls, where new players play heavy armor, big shield guys, because it feels so much safer. There's this thing in game design where basically the average player will do whatever they feel makes their life easier. It's very important to keep this in mind, especially for games with many customization options, because there could be more fun ways to play your game. I believe it was HBomberGuy that made a Dark Souls series analysis, where he said Bloodborne was the game that made him realize how to play the other Souls games in more fun ways, which was not using big shields and heavy armor. Armored Core 6 is directed by the guy responsible for both Bloodborne and Sekiro, which would lead me to think that they would make a game that really incentivizes fast gameplay. However, this shield thing really grabbed my attention because it says otherwise. Still, no biggie. If new players feel safer like this, I just hope that someday they will feel compelled to try new and faster builds. If you have played Armored Core before, notice how the player did the overboost thing to approach the enemy, boosted backwards, activated the shield, boosted like 3 times to get a better angle, and then did 2 strikes of their laser sword to the enemy. First of all, great pilot. But second of all, this really shows that energy management won't be too stressful, since in previous games I believe that this would deplete a lot of energy from many builds. It could be that these Armored Core parts have low energy use, though. I believe we might be able to get a look at this when they show the garage later in the video. Still, it would be great if the game was a bit more lenient on the energy side, so that most builds can make these very fun plays and not feel paralyzed by every action they do. Alright, scan time. There is a cooldown for this, which I don't even know if it's necessary, since you're only ever gonna need to do one scan before every room you enter. No need to do it when you're already in. Still, if it's included, there could be some cases. What I like about the scan is less on the hard gameplay side and more on the immersiveness it gives. really makes you feel like you're inside a high-tech machine that gives you all these advantages like wall hacking. This kind of fantasy is very important in games, of course. Otherwise, we would be playing with zeros and ones on a black screen. Alright, so this scene is an amalgamation of everything we have been discussing. Dynamic movement with side boosting, player choice is very enforced by the soft and hard lock-on thing. Great encounter. Really like the level design too. You can see there is a cover here on the right side, which could let a more careful player pick their targets one by one. The enemies on the left show a great use of simple verticality, where the simple fact that they're on a level below makes them prone to being tackled while ignoring the one enemy on the front there, since it wouldn't be able to shoot you in case you're here dealing with these two. There is also this lovable, very hot thing, I don't know. So you have to be careful in case you want to do this. Anyways, many ways to tackle this room. Really like it. Right, guard time. So there is this psychology concept called gestalt, and it deals with some aspects of the human perception. Some of these studies apply to graphic design and are widely used when making user interfaces for games too. For example, there's this gestalt principle named similarity. Basically, if things are similar, the human brain groups them together. There's also the proximity principle, the common region principle. So in this case, we have these two distinct boxes right here. One for the part specs and one for the overall specs of our armored core. It's easy to see that these specs are related to this and those specs are related to that. That is because they're next to each other, and those others are next to those others. They're clearly grouped together. There's also all this continuity here on the left for the available parts. Also, here on the left, we can see the focal point principle applied to the selected part, where it's brighter than everything else in the screen. And this makes sense, because this is the part that you would be changing in your current build, so it's the most important thing to pay attention to. Anyways, there are many other principles, and most of them are masterfully employed here. Some of these things might sound super obvious, and they kind of are, but together they help create a much better user experience, trust me. Alright, so as we can see, the player changed their AC loadout mid-mission to better suit the encounter that's about to happen. This has caused a bit of a controversy between Armored Core fans too. AC6 has checkpoints. You can also change your loadout in those checkpoints, show you want to do so. Some fans were mad at this, because in no other game in the series before could you change your loadout mid-mission, let alone checkpoints. Okay, first of all, in the last stages of most mission paths in Armored Core Last Raven, you had a checkpoint between the stage and the actual final boss. Still, alright. These were exceptions. Okay, so let's get to the meat of the discussion here. Missions in the previous Armored Core games last for 5-20 minutes maximum. Missions in AC6 are much bigger now, lasting for like 1 hour according to developer interviews. In between each mission in the previous Armored Core games, you could change your layout, so like every 5 or 10 minutes you would be able to change your layout. Having the ability to change it during missions now makes a lot of sense. No stress. Same thing for checkpoints. Also, same thing for the new Estus Flask-like mechanic. If missions are like 8 times longer now, of course you're gonna need a pick-me-up every now and then. No stress, guys. Okay, so now we go to my favorite part of this gameplay footage. As we can see, the more telegraphed attacks lead to a more purposeful positioning of your character, where you move your character to matters now. Okay, so look at the game loop here. Game loop is a very important concept in game design. Alright, so the player is now going through the ranged routine, where they are far from the enemy, safe, and they're making moderate damage from afar. Now for the dodging routine, vanilla stuff. Since this is a from top game, it's not very forgiving, so you have to focus more on dodging than attacking sometimes, as opposed to some, say, hack and slash games. This makes for a more methodical game. Now, for the melee attacking routine. The player now knows how the enemy acts, and because of that, they know when they can score a lot of damage more safely. So they cross the gap with the overboost, and for a great mix-up, they shoot right before side boosting, and then they do a close range attack where they kick this guy. Were this a Souls game, it would either be time to use a Nestus Flask safely or time for punishment. However, the carrying mechanic in AC6 is instantaneous, so there's no need to take the time to cure yourself. Time for more aggressiveness. And for that, the player crosses the gap again. With the enemy staggered, the player deals a 3-hit combo with their laser dagger for massive damage. So, before continuing, I just wanted to say that it seems like the player activates the dagger and the AC automatically boosts it towards the enemy. Then, here. Then dealing the melee strikes. This looks like how melee worked in the older games, where your character automatically followed the other guy a tiny bit when using a laser sword. Now, I have to talk about three things here. First, there's a combo system now. Second, charged shots. And third, stagger mechanics. So here, we can see the game really opens up for these amazing combos of combined melee and ranged attacks. There's this formal approach for game design called MDA, which stands for Mechanics, Dynamics, and Statics. Basically, a game mechanic is going to make a player act a certain way. This is then called dynamics. And the way the player acts and the way the game responds to that is going to make the player feel something. What the player is feeling is called statics. So, if you make a mechanic for your game, how is the player gonna act and how are they gonna feel about it? You can also design backwards. If you want the player to feel something specific, what kind of action do you want them to take and what kind of mechanic is gonna let them do it? Here in AC6, we have all these mechanics like the stagger system, having the ability to do both ranged and melee attacks, having the ability to choose between soft and hard lock-on. These mechanics together let the player make these awesome combos like the one we have just seen. This is gonna make players feel very powerful, like never before. And this will be a great sell for the "I'm controlling this huge super fighting robot" fantasy. And I think that's great. That's what the games are about, right? Controlling super fighting giant huge robots. Yeah. Okay. So, if we go back here, we can see that the player is charging a shot with their rifle. Here. See how it shines orange? Right after the kick and a side boost, they release one charge shot here that throws the enemy far away. And right here, the player does a charged sweeping melee attack. I really like this. I think that charge attacks, be it melee or ranged, are a great addition to this game, because they add a second way of interacting with the same button for a similar effect, giving the player more options. It's not a heavy load on the player brain, since it's the same button, and since the player actions, pressing the button longer, thus applying more force in real life, reflect the character actions on screen, and attack with more force. This also gives the player a great feeling, like you're connected to the game. Alright, so right here, the enemy gets staggered, right here. So, stagger mechanics are nothing new to the gaming landscape, ranging from old games like House of the Dead and to newer games like Sekiro. They're a great way of shaking up the gameplay a bit and letting the player make a little spectacle. If you know you're close to staggering an enemy, but you also know the enemy is about to attack you, are you going in hoping to stagger them, or do you make a safer escape? Staggering can offer some risk versus reward situations like this, and I think a little spectacle adds a lot to a game about giant, spectacular robots. There is, however, talk about how, with the focus on melee and stagger, Armored Core 6 is like mech Sekiro. I must emphasize this. Melee combos, stagger mechanics, giant bosses, curing yourself during combat, all of these mechanics existed in plenty other action-adventure games before. The fact that these are present in Dark Souls and Sekiro doesn't make Armored Core 6 a Souls-like. It makes it an action game like it has always been. If I'm being honest, to me, what makes a Souls-like is the mechanic of losing souls when you're killed, but also being able to retrieve those right where you died. This is the only really unique thing about those games. And this mechanic makes the game hard, because you lose your progress when you die, but also makes it mostly fair, because you can get those back. Anyways, getting sidetracked here. Awesome, love this. Yeah. Honestly, not much more I want to say here. Again, as you'll see, highly telegraphed attacks, that's cool, there. In a bit, the player will get staggered. This was a thing before in other games. Alright, shooting on weak points, right here. This makes these encounters feel more distinct from others, and that's cool. We did have giant boss encounters before in the series. Here, player gets staggered. But it seems that now there's a bigger focus on the big boss thing. It's cool. A spectacle makes for a memorable fight. I really like that this is a super creative enemy design. Look at this. Can't wait to see what other robot monstrosities they're gonna come up with. And for the gameplay analysis, that's basically it. I'm super excited for this game. I really like the older games, but this one seems to be on another level. I'm a huge sucker for laser swords and melee combat in general, so this looks right up my alley. Okay, so in the next video, I want to talk about mercenaries in video games. I will talk a bit about Armored Core in that video, but it shouldn't be the focus. In general, I want to talk about all kinds of games here, but, you know, as the channel's name implies, I'm a person that is very prone to hyperfixations, and that's why I started this channel even. So anyways, you can expect videos talking about all kinds of games and more serious subjects too in the future. That's it for today, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Cheers.